Hello, and welcome to Right On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the show where we talk about all things screenwriting. I'm your host, Phil Galasso. On today's episode, we have an interview with John Hamburg, whose work you know from the Zoolander films, I Love You Man, and his new film as writer-director, Me Time.
My wife is an architect. We made a decision that's best for me to take care of the kids.
It's called a system which works.
Yeah, prison system. That's what it sounds like.
What's up, Huck?
Honey, baby!
My birthday's coming up. You haven't been to one of my parties in forever.
You guys were so close.
And then I grew up. I don't want to spend a weekend with Huck and a bunch of 22-year-olds.
I have an idea.
I should take Dash and Ava for spring break by myself.
You've never traveled with them without me.
I am their mother. I will be fine.
Honestly, I have concerns.
Did you hear me? No. Dash, get your stuff.
John and I chatted about his approach to writing buddy comedy, balancing laughs and emotions on the page, how he got his start as a filmmaker, and more. Check it out. John Hamburg, thank you for taking the time to chat with me today.
My pleasure, Phil. Great to be here with you.
Describe the new movie. Describe Me Time for the listeners out there.
So, yeah, Me Time, Kevin Hart plays a stay-at-home dad, stay-at-home parent. His wife, played by Regina Hall, is kind of a superstar architect, and she's the breadwinner and always traveling and working crazy hours. And he overcompensates by being head of the PTA, director of the school talent show. He's making these crazy elaborate lunches for his kids. And his wife is feeling disconnected from the kids. And so she has this idea that she's going to take them on spring break to visit her parents by herself. And normally they go as a family. So Kevin finds himself basically alone in his house without his family for the first time in a decade. And, you know, thinks he has all these big plans. I'm going to do this and that. And it's the kind of thing where he hasn't been alone in so long that he truly has no idea what to do. And he sort of reluctantly ends up hooking up with his former best friend, played by Mark Wahlberg, who has taken a different path in life. He's 44, single, no commitments, and throws himself, no matter what the birthday year is, throws himself a huge epic birthday party every year. And Kevin ends up joining him on that party. And things go sideways from there.
Sideways, yeah. So with a story like this, with a film like this, where do you start? With the characters, with the concept? How do they work with each other? How do they tie into each other?
Yeah, it's a combo. I mean, I guess concept of, like, you know, somebody being alone for the first, you know, alone without their family for the first time in a while. That's like a very basic concept that could go a million different directions, obviously. With this one, I've been playing around with another idea about a Huck type character, Mark Wahlberg's character, Huck, you know, this kind of middle-aged sort of someone who never, you know, never started a family, just lives for the party and the experience. And so I had that character and I kind of morphed those two ideas, the idea of someone alone without their family, with the idea of kind of how people can grow apart and take different paths in life, and how you each feel like you think the grass is greener on the other side. And then the character comes. Then it's like, okay, well, who'd be interesting to run through, you know, this sort of parent who finds himself home alone for the first time in a long time? And the idea of a stay-at-home dad, oftentimes, you know, the idea of kind of flipping the genders, which is maybe more traditional, would be the mom who, you know, throughout history, women have done the bulk of parenting while, you know, men have sat in the sidelines. But obviously that's all changed in the last, you know, in the last few decades, or it's slowly changing, but it is changing. So I thought the idea of running this kind of character through it would be interesting, and someone who then is super insecure about his station in life. And so he would feel like this Huck character, this Mark Wahlberg character, would be kind of a threat to him because he's jealous, but he also thinks he's going to judge him. And so that, you know, I start to flesh out the characters and then the story kind of emerges from there.
A lot of your film, but, and you know, this one included, I'm curious because you're dealing with characters and heightened situations and all that, but very relatable characters, very relatable scenarios. What's your sort of process for, you know, balancing character and emotion versus just sheer laughs?
I mean, yeah, throughout my career, I've really aimed, even though I work in comedy and there are set pieces and giant, you know, crazy things that happen, I really do aim to keep the characters grounded and to treat them as human beings. I mean, frankly, even in a movie as absurd as Zoolander, you know, we tried to give an emotional arc to Derek Zoolander and to Hansel, you know, and it's no different with this movie that takes place in the real world. So I think, to me, it's like the more relatable and real the characters are, the funnier it will be. So I never have any scene that I think is just funny for funny's sake. I really have scenes that I think will allow the character to grow, to have conflict, you know, but based on these very specific characters that I've created and who I think of as three-dimensional people.
And, you know, this film is, and again, you've written other films throughout your career, like I Love You Man comes to mind, you know, the quote unquote buddies. Like when you're approaching this is a two-hander, right?
Yeah. But
when you're doing that, I imagine you know you've got Kevin Hart, you probably know you have Mark Wahlberg. How do you write a convincing relationship that has a history, that has drama, that has conflict?
Yeah.
You know, how do you approach that when you're sitting down to write the script?
I mean, again, I think it's thinking about the characters as real people. So, you know, thinking about what was their history? You know, we did a lot of talking of like, who were these guys in high school? Who were they in middle school? And unfortunately, I definitely had to cut some backstory from the script and even from the, you know, not so much in the final movie, but from the script, just because it gets too long and becomes kind of too much exposition. But at least I know that going in. So I've done that work to think about them as real people, think about a real relationship, you know, different from I Love You Man, where they're meeting for the first time, you know, Paul and Jason's characters. Mm-hmm. These two have a history. And so I just treated them as real people and thought it drew on my own experiences as like you grow apart from some people you were childhood friends with because you take different paths in life. And you may actually be more connected than you think you are, but sometimes our insecurities cause us to not reach out to our someone we were close with or things we think they'll judge us for the choices we've made. And so I think thinking about that each of these guys wants to connect with each other and they're better together than apart, which is, I think, a classic trope of buddy movies. And I definitely thought about that with these two. You know, Kevin's character kind of needs Mark's character to kind of open him up and allow that impulsive person to come through. And Kevin helps keep Mark on track. He's sort of spiraling out of control without Kevin's grounded nature in his life. So just thinking about them as these, you know, very specific characters with points of view really helps me to write them and to write, you know, these interpersonal dynamics that seems to be, I kind of can't get away from the buddy movie. I'm trying, but I come back to similar themes. So it's, what am I supposed to do?
Well, I'm curious, you know, when you're writing something that, you know, I don't know how much the buddy movie is a very specific genre because it can be stretched in so many different ways, but I'm curious, like when you're writing, are you conscious of, you know, the tropes that are associated with those types of stories? And, you know, are you trying to, you know, subvert them, avoid them, play into them? You know, what is your thought process like when you're working on it?
I don't think there's so many different types of buddy movies that, you know, there's certain beats. Okay. You know, they're going to bond at a certain point, you know, midway through the movie, and you know, they're probably going to break up. I mean, that's with a romantic comedy, with a buddy movie, it's just going to happen. Mm-hmm. And so I know those touchstones, and then I just try to create the most original story I can after that. I don't think too much about it. I think it's like, it's in my soul, the idea of these buddy movies. I you know, so I just kind of know it from watching a lot of movies and TV shows and reading a lot of stories that are two-handers. I just know it, but I aim not to think too much about it, just to kind of write them as well as I can.
That makes sense. So what is your process like in terms of how long does an idea percolate? Then, you know, you nail the idea down, like, okay, that's the one I'm going to do. Are you outlining a ton? How does it work for you?
I mean, it varies, but definitely I can percolate for a while, or I can leave something, you know. I think with this movie, like, I left it and went on, I think I made Why Him, and then kind of circled back to it when I started connecting the dots. And as I said, had this other idea with this Mark Wahlberg character and was like, oh, maybe that's a way to combine these two stories. So there's definitely, like, if an idea has legs for me, it stays for a while. I mean, I Love You Man was based on a script called Let's Make Friends by Larry Levin that I had read like 7 years prior. And years later, I, in almost a light bulb moment, I was like, oh, I know how I would do that story. You know, and I ended up writing my own version, basically, called I Love You Man, but based on that premise. So it can stick around for a while. And usually you know, if it keeps gnawing at me, I feel like there's something there. There's definitely other ideas when I look at my ideas folder that, you know, I'm like, oh, I never did that one, never did that one, you know. But if I'm obsessed with them, they come back around. And then, yeah, and then I start to, I kind of start to just have a document up that I just sort of freeform write a lot of different stuff. And then slowly I have another document that I start to put that into an outline. Like nowadays I have a producing partner, Lauren Hennessy, and we, you know, we'll talk things out a lot. So I'll work on my own and then we'll talk it out. And then I'll kind of go back and work on my own. And she's a great sounding board and a good writer on her own right. So it's super helpful.
So, and are you someone that, do you need to have a full outline where pretty much everything's fleshed out before you start actually writing the script? Or is it, you know, are you kind of writing bits and pieces as you're still figuring it out? How do you approach that?
So I wish I was one kind of writer, but I am a different kind of writer. So I wish I could just sit down and start writing. Cause I actually was saying this in another podcast that some of my cinematic heroes just did that. You know, 90% of us, I think, outline, and 10%, you know, sit down and suddenly, you know, Kill Bill comes out of it, or, you know, or whatever it is. But for me, the way my brain works is I kind of need to know the story. So I have a pretty detailed outline, and then I can write, you know, you've heard obviously the term vomit draft. Sure, and sure. Then I need to know the outline, and then I can write a vomit draft quite quickly. And that obviously varies from the outline, but it's not, tends not to vary that much, because I've done a lot of character work beforehand and a lot of story work. And I really have a good sense of what's happening. Mm-hmm. Then I will rewrite the script often significantly, you know, in some cases, but that's kind of how I start. So it's the crazy unformed document I would never share with another human, and then more of an outline, and then it ends up in the vomit draft.
Is your process different when you know you're directing, or do you not, you know, with this, did you know you were going to be directing it, I assume?
Yes. Yeah, I did. Yeah, it's not really different. I mean, it's, you know, recently, for the last quite a while, I've mainly done projects that I've directed or wanted to direct. I don't do too many assignments. Sometimes I'll do like script doctoring, you know, coming in and working on doing a production rewrite on a movie, or I've done TV pilots and stuff like that. But I've known I was directing those too. So yeah, Norm, I don't really think of them any differently. You know, sometimes when I'm doing a production rewrite, obviously it's different because there's another director and I'm working with them, and, or there's a star, and you know, the needs are very specific, but no, I think about it. I mean, I do think of like, where do I want to be? You know, where do I want to shoot this? What things like that, you know, because I have a family and that affects it. So as a writer director, you can control your destiny a little bit more than another.
You got to start writing those Adam Sandler movies where you can take your family on vacation to Europe.
Absolutely. I know. I'm just sort of sticking in LA for the moment. But yeah, he's a wise man.
Hey there. Did you know that Write On listeners can get 40% off Final Draft 12? Visit finaldraft.com and use discount code FDPOD at checkout. That's FDPOD. Final Draft, the industry standard screenwriting software. It all starts with the script.
He's doing it.
So, you know, you mentioned like, you know, you work with stars like Kevin Hart is someone you work with, Ben Stiller you've worked with, yep, a lot. When you're writing for someone, when there's a familiarity there, how does that change your approach and your process?
Yeah, it definitely, I mean, all the years that Ben and I were working on a lot of movies together, I would just have his voice in my head. And I really thought of him like a cinematic alter ego. You know, we're different in many ways, but we had, you know, a similarity in some ways and similar backgrounds, a little bit, both being from Manhattan, from New York City. And, you know, so that was like, I would just hear him in my head and was able to write, you know, and oftentimes it aligned with the voice, even if he wasn't involved, with the voice that I had in my head, if that makes sense. You know, with Kevin, obviously Kevin and I, very different types of people, different history and backgrounds, but yeah, we reconnected on his movie Night School, which I came in and did a rewrite on. And then when he came on board this, you know, I definitely did a significant rewrite for him, and it was really fun and liberating to just have him have his voice in my head. He's so specific. And so he knows what he wants. He's not going to always tell you, I want this scene, this scene, this scene, but he knows what works for him. And also, you know, he can riff. So we would have these long phone calls where he's just riffing And he's like, you know, John, what are, I'm doing this and I'm doing that. And I'm literally typing as fast as I can, writing this stuff down and hearing him in my head. He is just so explosively funny, just riffing. And I would, you know, use those phone calls, you know, or draw on them when I was revising the script with him in mind. And I felt like, you know, it just helped make it so much more authentic, both in plot and in voice to what Kevin is. And then, you know, with Kevin, then there's always, when you're on set, you know, if something I write doesn't sound quite right, he's going to make it his own, you know, and my job is like to make sure that it's the essence of the story or the joke that we're trying to hit, but that, you know, I want it to be feel authentic to him.
Taking kind of a big leap backwards, I'm curious, when did you first know you wanted to tell stories, to be a writer?
I was a comedy nerd kid. So comedy was my obsession. And growing up, it was like David Letterman, Eddie Murphy, Saturday Night Live, you know, Second City, all that, Steve Martin. Those were my obsessions. I didn't know, I thought I might be the editor of a Lampoon or of a comedy magazine. You know, and I just wanted to do something in comedy. And then my parents gave me a video camera when I was in high school, one of these massive half-inch tape video cameras. And I started making short films and kind of started finding my voice. But I wasn't really a writer or didn't really have dreams of being a writer at that point. It was in college when I took a playwriting class and I wrote a monologue and it was called Slacks. And it was based on me going clothes shopping with my dad, who was kind of not socially conservative, but kind of a, you know, a three-piece suit wearing lawyer. Sure, sure. And he took me to Brooks Brothers and I was miserable. And I wrote a monologue about that. And that was the first piece of writing where I was like, oh, I see what real writing is. I'm not saying that, you know, I think the piece turned out well, but it was more like I rewrote it and we performed it in front of an audience and I could hear where things worked and didn't. And that I was like, oh, I want to be a writer. That one thing, Michael Showalter, one of my college roommates, ended up performing it. And Teddy Shapiro, who's my longtime composer, directed the piece.
Oh, wow.
We all went to Brown University together. But that was the moment where it was, and then I started writing a lot and you know, just couldn't stop.
Take me from there to safe bet.
Sure. So I started making more short films and writing more, you know, short plays in college. And then I went to NYU Film School and I made two movies there. I dropped out after my second year of NYU grad school. But I made a short called Tick. Also starring Mike Showalter and our good friend Mark Shanahan and our friend Nina Hellman. And so I made that, and it was like a 10-minute kind of slacker comedy, high concept, but done in a low-key way. Mm-hmm. And that movie got into Sundance as a short film, and kind of I literally went to Sundance with the script for Safe Men, which I had written as a feature, in my suitcase. It was before everyone emailed this and that. I mean, I had, you know, I was like a traveling salesperson almost. Went to Sundance to screen Tick, my short, met some producers. And, you know, basically what happened was these producers I met, Jonathan Cohen and Jeff Clifford, they met with me and they loved Tick, the short, and they loved the script for Safe Men. And they ended up getting the financing together. And through Andrew Hauptman and Ellen Hauptman, his wife, and we put the movie together and were able to make it as an indie, you know, back in 1998. It came out in 97.
Very cool. So as someone who's, you know, worked within the sort of studio system or whatever you want to call it these days, it's not quite the classic Hollywood of the 1940s and 50s, but I'm curious, you know, beyond just being a good writer, what do you see as some of the skills that have allowed you to build a career in terms of, you know, building relationships, being good in the room, that sort of stuff? What has worked for you?
I mean, I think it starts with voice, right? I mean, I felt like all I have that other people don't have is my voice. You know, other people have their voices. I have my voice. I have my point of view, and I want to develop that. And so I worked a lot on that, of, you know, through trial and error of trying to write stuff that wasn't in my genre, trying to write stuff that I thought would sell and falling on my face, you know. So I started to find my voice, and I think that was very helpful, because I think people were like, okay, there's a lot of scripts out there that are good but maybe not as specific, and this guy seems to have a specific point of view. Whether you like my work or not, I think I have a specific point of view. So I developed that, and then I love the collaborative nature of movie making or TV. You know, I just, to me, it's like being open, knowing that a good idea could come from anywhere, aiming not to be defensive, you know, and just take it in. I think that's helped me a lot. And it's made my work better. I definitely see writers where you can see they're defensive or they immediately shut things down. And I think once you realize, like, you're not always going to get the solution, you know, to an idea from a star, from the producer, from the studio executive. But if they have a problem with something, it's really, they're pretty experienced for the most part. So it's worth thinking about what's holding them back. And they're, you know, and so I think being open and quite collaborative has helped me a lot. And listening, you know, I think listening to the voices of actors, you know, even like as early as Meet the Parents, you know, where I was brought on to do a rewrite, you know, pretty early in my career, listening to Robert De Niro and the rhythms of how he speaks and aiming to put that into the script, you know, or even Jay Roach, who's such a great director, you know, he listening to him say, like, this movie's an anxiety dream for Greg Focker. He had that through line, you know, the script evolved a lot through myself and other writers, but trying to take in, what does that mean? You know, and then constantly rewriting, you know, in my own work, writing and directing, you know, not going, this is the script. I mean, I revere the Coen brothers and I feel like they have a script and that's it. You know, you're pretty much
changed the word of that.
Yeah. And they're awesome. And I aspire to do movies as anywhere near as good as theirs. For me, I do a different thing. And so it's this ever evolving thing where you don't know what's going to work. You know, you have a confident vision, but I always say it, I always consider myself an open-minded control freak. Mm-hmm. So I want to control a lot, but I want to have an open mind. And I think all those things certainly help me. And then a lot of it's luck. I was in the right place at the right time and, you know, had some doors open for me. And I met Ben Stiller at the right time. He randomly saw Safe Men, my first movie, at a film festival. You know, Safe Men was not a hit. It's become a bit of a cult movie, but it was in theaters for 2 weeks and got mixed reviews, decidedly. But Ben Stiller saw something in it and we connected. And next thing you know, we started collaborating. And out of that came, you know, Zoolander. And, you know, we worked on Meet the Parents together and Along Came Polly and a bunch of other things. So those kind of fortuitous things, you know, I was ready when they happened, but they were fortuitous.
So just kind of building on that last question before we wrap up, is there something you've learned, you know, throughout the course of your career that you kind of wish you could go and tell yourself when you were first starting out?
Good question. I think the hardest thing for me was comparing myself to others. And it took me a while to stop doing that. And I fall into that trap today, having been in the business for more than 2 decades. You know, I love to be inspired by other people's work. And I am always often inspired by stuff I see, movies, TV. But back then, especially, I, you know, was, why aren't I like this? Why aren't I as good as this person? Both established filmmakers, or you'd read an article in Variety about some 24-year-old that sold something. And I was like, oh, well, I should do that. So I think the advice I would give a younger, more naive John Hamburg is like, just focus on yourself and listen, you know, watch stuff and get inspired. But, you know, you have your own path and it has nothing to do with what anybody else is doing. And so that could have saved me a lot of stress back in the day. Does that make sense?
I mean, that makes a lot of sense. So when can people watch the movie?
So Me Time will be available on Netflix August 26th around the world. And it doesn't take itself too seriously. It's a fun ride and, you know, fun, sweet movie. And you'll get some laughs and sit on your couch and forget about the state of the world for 95 minutes.
Can confirm. Well, John, thank you so much for taking the time to chat today.
My pleasure. Thank you so much, Phil. Appreciate it.
Thanks again to John Hamburg for coming on the show. You can stream Me Time on Netflix starting August 26th. And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you liked this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to the show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Emma Vranich. Editing is by Sean Bonnet. Music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.